It's an old trope. The hero needs to escape, so she pulls out a lighter and trips the fire sprinklers around the whole building. Is that just movie magic? How do those things know when there's a real fire around? Howdy hotties, thanks for stopping by DNews today. I'm Trace. Fire is one of the most serious disasters facing human construction projects throughout history. Fires destroyed Constantinople, Rome, Amsterdam, Tokyo, Moscow, London, San Francisco, Hong Kong, Chicago, Singapore, Tianjin. They can start anywhere and spread anywhere. Fire suppression systems are universal in so many movies and TV shows. But according to the National Fire Protection Association, all the sprinklers going off at once is absolutely a work of fiction. In the 19th century, textile mills began installing perforated pipe systems, which could manually be flooded with water to put out a fire before it got out of hand. Then, in 1872, the first automatic system was created and was perfected 2 years later by the owner of a piano factory named H.S. Parmalee. The system used heat-activated material that released the tension on a spring, allowing water to flow through the pipe. And modern systems dating to 1889 pretty much do the same thing, but today we're using a piece of glass to hold back the water. Because of this heat-activated bead, only sprinklers subjected to hundreds of degrees will spray water, not every sprinkler everywhere. If you look at a fire sprinkler today, you'll likely see a tiny glass bead filled with liquid or a color-coded piece of metal called a fusible link. The beads are easiest to spot, and the color of that bead tells you how hot the ceiling can get before the sprinkler will go off. These systems work with simple physics. Inside the bead is a glycerin-based liquid, sugar alcohol, which expands when heated to a specific temperature. That expansion breaks the glass, allowing what's inside of the pipe to come out. A hotel or a home goes up in flames more quickly and at lower temperatures than, say, a factory. So different buildings will have different classifications. Red beads break at the lowest temperature of 135 to 170 degrees, so they're the most common. Intermediate levels are yellow or green, and they break at 175 to 225, and it's a range. The highest levels are for warehouses and factories. They have black beads, which break at 650 Fahrenheit. The thing is, what comes out of the sprinkler doesn't just have to be water. It can also be an inert gas or foam designed to snuff out really strong fires in sensitive areas. But if it is a liquid, there are two kinds of suppression systems, wet or dry. Wet systems have pipes that are filled with water at all times, and dry systems have nothing in them until a broken bead upsets the vacuum balance so they can fill with water. Dry systems are better for places where freezing temperatures could damage the pipes, or perhaps where a leak could seriously damage the building, like, say, a historic site. Now, I know I said otherwise, but there are systems where all the sprinklers will turn on at once. They're called deluge systems, and they're used in places where huge fires could get out of control quickly, like power plants, aircraft hangars, and chemical storage or processing facilities. Not so much office buildings, even fictional ones run by spies. So next time you're in a hotel or you spot a sprinkler head out in the wild, remember, it's connected to a massive system of pipes designed to keep your building from fire harm. You can nerd out about the color of the bead and scoff at every movie that uses the fire sprinkler trope. You're welcome. And if you're into crazy things about fire and debunking movies, you should learn about how fire works in space, because again, pretty much every movie gets it wrong. Check out the old video that I did about it here. Wow, what was I thinking with that hair? Fire consumes the oxygen and heats the air. The hotter air rises, and the heavier, cooler, unburned air sinks, replenishing the fire's fuel. Thanks, gravity. In space, this cycle doesn't happen. There's no such thing as lighter or heavier air in microgravity. Thus, the fire heats the air, which just sits around the flame, causing it to burn slowly. What else do you want to know about the world around us? Any other systems you want us to dig into? Let us know in the comments. Make sure you use the hashtag AskDNews if you tweet at us. And thanks for tuning in. Make sure you subscribe so you get more DNews.